I'm Michael Johnson. I've won 4 Olympic golds in sprinting. At this level of my sport, nearly all the athletes are black. But there's another connection, a hidden and more disturbing bond. Almost every one of us is descended from slaves. Is that a coincidence? I'm lifting the lid on a heartbreaking story.
Slaves had to lie in body fluids such as urine and fecal material, diarrheal fluid, and so on.
With inhumanity at its core.
There was no such crime as the rape of a slave woman.
I come face to face with my own slave ancestors.
Nuh-uh.
She looks sort of proud right there.
It's a controversial connection that could be exploited by racists.
There is a worry that the cliche of the black man has more testosterone, is more aggressive.
But if it's true, it's a story of how some of the most brutalized people on Earth rose to become its super athletes. I worked hard during my career to accomplish what I did. I put my success down to talent and dedication. To many, the idea that slavery might have contributed to this success is controversial. The last guy who suggested that lost his job.
CBS sports commentator Jimmy the Greek Snyder is in hot water tonight over some remarks he made today about black athletes. He said they are better than white athletes for reasons that go back to slavery.
The slave owner would breed his big black to his big woman so that he could have a big black kid, see? Now, I mean, that's where it all started.
People were appalled by the racist implications. But is there any truth in it? I'd like to find out. I'm going to start with myself. I don't know much about my ancestors, where they came from, or what happened to them. I'm hoping that hidden in their story, there is some evidence that explains what makes me so fast.
I'm wanting to look at a death certificate and try to trace back some family genealogy. I've got a name, but that's all I've got.
Who is the person that you're looking for today?
It's Leora Melinda Johnson.
Leora Johnson is my great-grandmother on my father's side.
Have you been doing genealogy long?
Not very long.
Not very
long. I haven't gotten very far.
Did you know your great-grandmama?
I didn't know her.
It's all in alpha order.
Okay. Wow.
Like many in my community, I've always made a point of looking forward.
There she is, 86.
But is there a clue in our history that would explain our athletic ability?
Osage. So there's the death certificate number. Now that we've got this, we can look at the microfilm of the actual death certificate.
Okay.
And now we will just scroll forward until we reach 78738.
Here she is, my father's grandmother.
Leora Melinda. Well, look, we also see that she was buried at Evergreen Cemetery.
Where is that?
In Austin, Texas.
Wow.
It's pretty amazing.
It is amazing. It's been here all of this time, and I didn't even know I could come down here and find it.
You bet.
Now we're going even further back to look for her father. And here he is.
Here is your third great-grandfather,
Powell Earls. And he was born February 16th, 1865. Your great, great, great grandfather, Powell E. Earls, would have been born a slave.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Huh. That's amazing.
Now, his father and mother would have been slaves. That's correct.
Yeah.
And that's as far back as these records go. The births and deaths of slaves weren't seen as worth recording.
Their parents probably, they got their first names from the slave master, and they didn't even have a last name. Just had a name and an age, you know, and that then really brings home the fact that these individuals, their identity was taken from them, everything was taken from them, you know. Not just their freedom, but their identity was even taken. That's pretty sad. It's pretty difficult to have to deal with.
If I'm going to dig further into my past, I need the support of my family.
Actually, today went to the Dallas Public Library to start the process, trying to figure out where we came from.
My parents, Paul and Ruby Johnson. My sisters, Cheryl, Regina, and Deidre. And finally, my brother, Paul Jr., and his wife, Karen. I'm the youngest. I always joke that the reason I run so fast is because I had to learn to get away from them when I was a kid.
Leora, she was 86 years old when she died. So that bodes well for the rest of us.
Yeah, I like that. I like that.
Yeah, you like that? Yeah, you liking that, huh?
Yeah.
Like me, my family were intrigued by the records.
So from there, I was able to then go and find Powell's Earl's death certificate. And what's interesting about him, his parents would have in all likelihood been slaves.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Sex male, color or race, Negro.
Back then, color definitions and terms linked to slavery still defined who we were as a people. To break through the prejudice, you had to be very special indeed. Like my hero, Jesse Owens. He rose to the top against a backdrop of segregation. At college, he was not allowed to live or eat with white members of the athletics teams. His struggle and success is an inspiration to me.
This is pretty normal for springtime, and it's random. You never know when you're gonna have this kind of crazy weather. There's a saying in Texas, if you don't like the weather, just wait a minute, it'll change.
I always knew I was descended from slaves, but had no idea that just a few hours' drive away, my great-great-grandfather, born a slave, was buried.
Now I'm gonna try to find this location of Evergreen Cemetery, which is found it, Airport Boulevard, and what did I say? Okay, it's right there. I found it, and we're off. Just checking it all out. Wonder what Powell Earls was like, what kind of person he was, what his life was like. Sure, it wasn't easy. Life wasn't really easy back then. Some people had it better than others. It was always a struggle, though.
I am a father, I'm a son. I'm a brother. But I can see now that I am part of a much bigger story stretching back hundreds of years. Perhaps somewhere in that history is what enabled me to become one of the fastest men on Earth.
I think it's important for people to know, you know, who their ancestors were. You know, all of that I've been able to do in my life and pursue my own dreams, and what my kids are able to do is partially due to the sacrifices that they made and the hard work that they put in their own lives.
I was hoping to find more clues here, but I think I'll need expert help to explore my family tree further. In the meantime, I'm going to come at my history from the opposite direction.
The slave coast stretched 3,000 miles from Senegal all the way down to Angola. Slave dealers would capture men, women, and children from the interior of Africa and march them hundreds, even thousands of miles over to the coast. I would imagine that the journey would take weeks, if not months. There are pictures here, illustrations of the actual journey with men, women, and children shackled. The weaker ones would have perished in the journey.
My ancestors must have survived this grueling journey. I'd be fascinated to know where they came from, but millions were captured indiscriminately from across the continent.
There's no real way to know exactly what the numbers were, but the estimates are that 50% of those who were captured didn't make it to the coast. And in the end, they would be housed in dungeons and cells on these prison castles. Obviously, the objective was to take the strongest and the fittest if they could, and those would be the ones that would actually make the journey to the New World. So one would wonder, is this then an inadvertent selection of the fittest? And in the end, they would go through the door of no return, board the ship, and they would never see their home again.
I'd like to go where many slaves ended up. It's the only place that rivals the U.S. on the sprint track. Jamaica. I'm Michael Johnson. I've come to Jamaica. A tiny island, but home to the world's fastest athletes. What's behind their success? Are there clues in our shared slave history? At the 2008 Olympics, Jamaica dominated the sprints. Six gold medals and a guy named Usain Bolt beat my 200-meter record and became the fastest man on Earth.
It is truly an amazing story that this very small country is the one place in the world where sprinting really is the national sport. And as a sprinter myself, it will be interesting to see, what are the contributing factors. And if we go all the way back to Africans being uprooted, stolen, taken from their families, beaten, it's just atrocious treatment. It's a very sad thing.
But perhaps Jamaican success has nothing to do with slavery. Perhaps it is more to do with hard work and a culture where sprinting is venerated.
What's your name? Robert, nice to meet you.
What do the Jamaicans put it down to? These kids are the next generation.
Why is everybody so fast in Jamaica? What's the deal? You don't know.
Maybe the yam and banana.
The yam and banana. Even if you slow, you come down here to Jamaica, eat some yam and banana, then all of a sudden you're fast. Right?
Yes.
A little bit of training. You got to train a little bit, though?
Yes.
Jamaican athletic facilities are now improving. But despite having new facilities, their athletic teams focus less on cutting-edge technology and the science of speed.
So you guys train hard? You fast?
70%.
70%? You 70% fast?
Yes.
What about the other 30%?
Still working on it,
still working on it, all right. So what's making Jamaican athletes so fast?
Maybe I just love the country for uplifting, you know?
It's uplifting. Just,
yeah. Just uplift the country and make people recognize Jamaica more.
Yeah.
You know, realize, yo, we're black people.
Right.
So we're just as good as the whites.
Yeah. That's interesting. There could certainly be a psychological factor, a desire to prove themselves.
Dr. Elliott, how are you?
Not bad, thank you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, man.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Yeah, thanks for...
Herb Elliott is the Jamaican Olympic team doctor. He has a different theory. His work leading up to the Beijing Olympics saw the team take the games by storm.
There's just so many world-class sprinters, male and female, coming from Jamaica. What is it about Jamaican kids that make them want to be sprinters, and then how do they become so great?
What happened was that in Jamaica's case, we were the last stop coming from Africa. What occurred there, of course, was that the toughest ones survived the trip to Jamaica. The more docile ones were sold in those other countries. The more aggressive ones and the fiercest ones, if you will, ended up in Jamaica.
He has an interesting point. The slave traders used Jamaica as kind of a dumping ground for the most troublesome slaves. Slave uprisings were common, but rebellions were brutally crushed. Those who tried to escape would be shot. Hunger strikers were force-fed human excrement. To survive the savage conditions, you had to be seriously tough. And 90% of Jamaicans today are descended from these slaves.
So the sprints, obviously, it's a high ballistic activity. It's a quick power activity, yes, as opposed to the distance races. And so that aggressiveness that you feel is natural to the Jamaican
comes out
would contribute to the sprints more so. Then is there any other reason why?
Well,
the
remember,
sprints were
too,
more...
we are egotists. Mm. We like to win.
I want to know if what I've heard can be backed up scientifically. So I'm on my way to meet Dr. William Aitken, a research scientist from the University of the West Indies. He is one of the few scientists in the world to have studied the long-term impact of life on the slave ships.
The conditions were suffocating. They were extremely hot and humid, and the smell was overpowering and offensive. We know from historical records that the mortality, and we have it right here, and we see where the mortality is as low as 51% to as high as 96%. So we see that the mortality on these slave ships were very high. So if you started a journey with, say, 100 slaves who had varying levels of testosterone, and you ended up with only 50 slaves at the end of the journey, I am saying that there is a higher proportion of those slaves who are more testosterone responsive than the slaves who originally started the journey. And what I did was to look at the actual conditions under which the slaves were transported.
It's shocking what he's describing. In these ships, men, women, and children were packed like animals. The living chained to the dead on voyages taking up to 6 months. Their human cargo was insured by the likes of Lloyd's of London. The survivors of these atrocities went on to build Jamaica.
Then when you look at things like muscular strength, these things would have contributed to the slaves being better able to survive the journey being better able to survive slave beatings and so on. As you know, if you're a slave on a slave ship and you developed an injury, you were tossed overboard. They weren't going to carry you.
Testosterone is a hormone associated with strength, muscle mass, and physical ability. Those with a higher responsiveness to it would have been better able to survive the journey.
It is basically a selection.
Absolutely.
Of the individuals from Africa who were put on the ship, and those who survived were the ones who basically at the end of the day had the superior athletic ability through higher testosterone.
Correct.
And all of these things contributed. And so what is concentrated now in the Americas are descendants of the fittest, basically, that were taken from Africa.
Right.
And so that transatlantic voyage, as difficult as it was and as tragic as it was for so many Africans, has actually benefited some of today's great athletes, and I would be one of those.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So here's the theory. Slavery was kind of an unnatural selection, a speeded up evolution, a mass murder of the weakest. Only the fittest able to survive and pass on their genes to the next generations. And some geneticists also argue that periods of great stress can trigger evolutionary change within just one generation. So perhaps the notion that slavery made us faster isn't so far-fetched. And if that's true, it makes another extraordinary story even more ironic. In 1936, Hitler assembled the finest German athletes at the Berlin Olympics to prove his theory of Aryan supremacy. But Jesse Owens, the grandson of a slave and my hero, had other ideas. He wanted America to boycott the Berlin Olympics, but when that failed, Owens took his protest onto the track. He won 4 gold medals. He didn't just destroy the myth of white supremacy. He threw Hitler's Nazi ideology back in his face.
I ran in that stadium. That was incredible. First time I ran there was 1990. And walking in there, knowing that Jesse Owens actually ran in the stadium where you see now with everyone with the Nazi salute. And these black athletes had to compete in front of this crowd, and they could probably imagine that there was nobody in there rooting for them. It's incredible, you know. When I see Jesse Owens running, I can appreciate him first and foremost as an athlete, and as an incredible athlete, and one of the most, if not the best sprinter of all time.
I wonder if Jesse Owens and I have something genetically in common, shaped by slavery. Is that even feasible on a genetic level?
Hello, Dr. Irvin, how are you?
Good to meet you.
I'm meeting geneticist, Dr. Rachel Irvin.
How are you? See what I'm made of.
She's taking a DNA sample to try and find out which part of Africa I originally came from. I'll get the result later. Like Aitken, she believes the slave crossings have affected our genomes. But there's a sting in the tail.
So what is very, very bad about it is that family members of those that are, you know, good sprinters tend to have diabetes. And you speak to your family.
My grandfather died of diabetes, and my mother has diabetes.
So the legacy of slavery on our genes might not only be athletic success, but also diseases like prostate cancer and diabetes. So it does seem there are genetic legacies from our slave history. It's starting to make sense, but it's unfortunate if it proves true.
There is a worry that the cliche of the African man or African American man or black man is stronger, bigger, has more testosterone, but that doesn't automatically make an individual who's descended from Africa more aggressive, just like it wouldn't automatically make an individual who has descended from Africa a great sprinter. Otherwise, I wouldn't be a special athlete. We would all be, you know, if it were that easy.
Next, I want to follow the slavery trail onwards to America, where the story for me gets closer to home. I myself am a pretty good example of an elite athlete. I still hold the world record for the fastest ever 400 meters. Why is it that almost all the best sprinters like me seem to be descended from slaves? Is there anything in the history of American slavery that points to a survival of the fittest?
This is a picture here of an actual auction from the London Times. This took place in Virginia, and you have a male slave here, a female slave, and actually a baby as well. And the slavers would actually fatten up the slaves once they arrived so that they would look presentable and be more attractive to the potential owners. This is very interesting. This is a price list. So, for example, a man who is listed as a common man would be priced at $775 to $850. But an extra man who is probably physically physically superior and able to take on more labor for the slave owner would be priced at $1,275 to $1,300. I would imagine that the slavers would be looking for those individuals who were physically stronger because they knew that that's what the plantation owners would be looking for.
It's profoundly disturbing that these slave traders and purchasers of slaves could dehumanize people in this way. I have only been able to trace as far back as my great-great-grandfather, Powell Earls. But one of the leading African-American genealogists, Tony Burroughs, has been digging further.
Oh, man, well, you know, I've been looking at you since the 1990s and 80s, you
right.
know. I used to run 220 back when I was in high school, you know?
That would have been a while ago.
Yeah.
I had got as far as Powell Earls.
Right.
But Tony has found his mother. She was called Frances Battle.
The males. Now, here's Frances and her son Powell.
In the local slave owner records, there is another person with the surname of Battle.
And over here, we see Irella Battle Walker. She married Joseph Walker and her family. I think that they were sisters.
Mm. Wow.
That's deep, isn't it? From 1880.
Tony had found not only my great-great-great-grandmother, Frances, but also her sister, Irella. He couldn't find any more about Frances, but with Irella, he struck gold.
People were fascinated through slavery and slave history, and they interviewed formerly enslaved people.
Okay.
And many of those have been published. There were like thousands of them. In fact, about maybe 8,000 narratives.
Okay.
And I think we got lucky. This is one of the interviews with Ira Battles.
This was way beyond my expectations. My ancestor Irella had actually narrated the story of her life as a slave.
She says here that she, the only education she got was from another former slave named Jack James, but she's sure that the master did not know about James's teaching abilities.
Yeah, he ran a night school there, she said.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And that's where she learned how to read. She said she couldn't write well, but she learned how to read pretty good. Mm-hmm. And as you know, or you may or may not know, it's against the law to teach slaves how to read,
right? Right.
Now, is it kind of exciting, isn't it?
holding out on me.
No. I found something else here, man. I know you want to see it. What does that say?
Let's see. Walker, Irella, battle.
Mm-hmm. If you turn the page, you'll see what's on the front.
Oh, there. Nuh-uh. Wow. They always take pictures?
No. Only a few of them. A small number had photographs. Because again, photography in the 1930s wasn't real popular.
Right.
You know.
Wow. That's amazing.
Isn't that amazing?
So this would be my great, great, great grandmother's sister.
Right.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Until today, these people, my family, had been hidden away in a dusty file. But now I'm looking into the face of my past.
She looks like a woman that has probably seen some very difficult years. But she looks very, she looks sort of proud right there. I doubt there were very many weak women back then. The circumstances just made you tough. It had to be just to survive. And hopefully, you know, that same toughness that they, you know, exhibited to get through daily life and to survive was passed down through, you know, the generations. And so the more you learn about who my ancestors were, the more I learned about maybe why I am the way that I am. Because, you know, any athlete with talent still has to have a mentality of hard work and understanding how hard you have to work and how hard you have to sacrifice and push yourself in order to be the best that you can be. My maiden name was Irella Battle, and I was born on August 15th, 1851. I was 86 years old in August, just passed, and I'm blind in one eye. It's hard for me to see anything. Mammy was a field worker, medium-sized woman. When I was a baby in my mama's arms, I was sold to Master Tom Washington. Master Washington had a large cotton and corn plantation in the east part of Travis County. About the masters, some of them was good and some was bad, and about the most of them was bad. I was still pretty young when I first went to the fields. Old man Jones kept us diving for that cotton all day long. There was many times when us children wished that old man Jonas was dead. He sure was hard on us.
I'm trying to understand the athletic ability of super athletes. But Irella's testimony has got me thinking about the women in this story for the first time. Dr. Juliet Walker is a professor of African American history at the University of Texas.
Wanted to get your perspective on just the experience of, and in particular, the experience of women in slavery and what life was like for them.
What stands out is the degree to which they were sexually exploited. Remember, slaves were property. And there was no such crime as the rape of a slave woman.
So what type of methods would they use then in order to achieve that objective of getting that woman pregnant and producing more slaves?
Okay, there are several ways. One, the owner could say, okay, Lizzie, I want you to go with Rufus. Go. You're a portly woman. He's a portly man. I want you all to have some portly children. Okay.
And the slave owner would actually seek out these particular individuals and try to and attempt to mate them together.
Yes, yes, yes.
Like you would do with cattle.
Absolutely. You know. And I would just, you know, there were some slaves, some men, who didn't mind the job. I'm sorry to say, you know.
How would a woman deal with that? And was there anything she could have done to maybe prevent that?
Those who refused would be beaten. And then, you know, you read some of the slave narratives and they would say, you know, okay, I tried to, you know, resist, but I just will have to go on. Right. And do this. It was open season on black women. It was open season.
There is some debate about the extent of these horrific breeding programs, but the fact that they even existed is extraordinary.
The whole issue of slave breeding is tremendously important. Because what is significant about the black historic experience is that it is a history of survival that is not emphasized. And one tremendous example of that survival can be found in black women who were subjected to sexual exploitation, who were subjected to slave breeding, were passed from one man to the next. And they survived, they had children, and they passed survival on to their kids.
It's clear that a mindset of survival is a crucial part of this story, because success or failure is down to a lot more than the genes you inherit. It could also be to do with the desire to triumph over a history of struggle and oppression. In 1936, Jesse Owens returned to the U.S. from the Hitler Olympics. Despite all his achievements, he was still treated as a second-class citizen, quickly dropped by the American Athletic Association, and turned away from hotels he had been booked into. By the end of his athletic career, the only work he could get was at local fairs, providing entertainment by racing against racehorses. Sport is a small microcosm of society, so as long as there have been racial discrimination, there would have been, you know, that would have found its way into sport. So you take 1968 during the Civil Rights Movement, and athletes were still being discriminated against, black people were still being discriminated against. And so there is the very famous Black Power salute by John Carlos and Tommy Smith. They were standing up and trying to bring attention to the civil rights issue. I've always known I stand on the shoulders of these athletic giants. But I now know my inheritance stretches much further back in time. There's one final piece of the puzzle I need to solve. And it's to be found on the beaches of California. One morning, Master Washington told his house girl to go out and tell his slaves to come up to the yard. He had a big paper, and he read from it. He then told us, "You folks is now free. You is now free to live and free to die. Free to go to the devil if you want to." Master turned, walked away, and started crying. All of the slave family stayed, and just one man left. Thankfully, slavery was abolished in 1865. The highest price that he paid anybody for helping to gather the crop was about $15. This seemed like a lot of money to folks that wasn't used to getting no money for their farm work. Freedom for most slaves meant being paid to do the same job. A lot of us would go along and pick the cotton and then make up songs to sing. This incredible rare footage is one of the earliest records of freed slaves. But did our ancestors' struggle actually help some of us become the world's fastest men?
Cambridge University's Professor Bill Amos has spent a lifetime studying evolutionary genetics.
I think dissecting how much that contributes is unclear.
That makes sense to you, that if the best of the best were selected, then maybe you end up with this group of people who have survived who are physically superior, maybe.
Absolutely. And there's more and more information coming through, both from human studies and particularly from animal studies, I think. So this is one of the reasons we're on the beach in an area where we find elephant seals, because these guys were hunted, they were declared extinct. And in going down to such small population numbers, they probably lost a lot of those harmful mutations that were previously just making them a little less fit. And it's an amazing thing. Elephant seals illustrate it fantastically. They've rebounded from being declared extinct around 1900 to, I think, the current population around here is around 200,000. That's an amazing rate of increase for a large mammal. It's almost like they're super fit. They've really seemed to have just exploited the fact that they've got rid of this kind of genetic load, that they're the baggage that they've been carrying.
So just like the seal population was nearly wiped out and bounced back with a vengeance, the same might be true of the descendants of slaves.
By subjecting it to stress, I would say you almost certainly you can, and I'd be really surprised if the survivors of the slave trade weren't actually genetically cleaner in some sense. I don't mean anything particular by that, apart from the fact that they've lost a lot of these potentially harmful mutations that everybody else has probably a bit more of.
So taking it then one step further, could that then potentially be an answer as to why then the descendants of those who survived the slave trade may be physically, athletically superior?
I think it could contribute quite considerably.
But there's a really important note of caution here. There are other possible factors.
The environmental effects, and this is the thing that's plagued this kind of study for so long, is that you've got people who are brought up in a culture where everybody wants to be a sprinter or everybody wants to be a footballer and stuff, and that's going to bias the results a lot. So you've got to be pretty canny.
Professor Amos believes that the unnatural selection of the fittest could have contributed to improved athletic performance. But then he blew me away with an even stronger theory connecting sprinting success and slavery.
And what we do know about the slave population is that they were brought in from many different parts of Africa. Africans in general have higher diversity than non-Africans. And if you then put them together, particularly if their genomes are a bit cleaner than they were before, you then have the potential for generating very high levels of fitness.
The slave traders just saw their captives as black. But they were, in fact, mixing together incredibly different groups. From the Kalahari Bushmen in the south to the Yoruba of Nigeria in the west. This genetic diversity could be the advantage I've been looking for.
It gives you a wonderful melting pot. So if you're keen on athletics, you have a better chance of finding the Usain Bolts of this world, the Michael Johnsons of this world.
So his theory is that the slave population had an incredibly rich gene pool with the widest range of potential talent. Did that contribute to my success? The scientists have one last gift for me. My DNA results have arrived, telling me where in Africa I'm from.
All right, let's see here. Interesting, already. Michael Johnson is about 7/8 African. The type reaches a peak in frequency in Senegal.
I'm an example of the kind of diversity he's talking about, with bits of my DNA coming from all over Africa. But there's one place that shows up more clearly.
The deeper origin is in West Africa, And your mitochondrial DNA group is Takruri, that of the ancient and wealthy kingdom of Takrur. That makes me happy. Based on the lower reaches of the Senegal River on the Atlantic coast of Africa, the kings of Takrur wielded great power between 800 and 1285. That all makes sense. Why I yield so much power. That's kind of cool. Very cool.
It's extraordinary how the science and the history are coming together.
I'm hopeful that, you know, what I have discovered and what I have been able to present will provoke some thought. And people will have their own opinion and make up their own minds. It's undeniable, in my opinion, that there has been some effect from slavery on the athletic ability of the descendants of slaves.
I am just part of a long line of people who managed to survive and pass on their legacy.
My folks moved on a farm down on Onion Creek near Delval, Travis County. We rented farmland from Nat Waters and Dr. Shears. We stayed on this place about 6 years. We raised cotton and corn. I helped in the fields like all the rest. After this, when I was about 20 years old, I was married to Joe Walker. He was a farmer. We moved on down to Bastrop County, where we stayed till my husband died on September 2nd, 1932. We had 11 children, 6 girls and 5 boys. 9 of the children is living.